just to cover, what is Google Analytics? Basically, it's data about who visited your website and where from. So who here in the room currently isn't using Google Analytics?
Okay. Excellent. So basically, a lot of people don't have sort of any metrics and bits and pieces of their site. So it's basically, why do you need to know this sort of information? If you're doing site changes, so if you're changing themes, you're adding plugins, you're adding content, you want to be able to measure what those changes are. So you want to see before and after. Are you getting more visitors? Are you getting less? Sometimes not everything is a positive sort of spin, so you want to be able to measure what's actually occurring for your site. If you're doing any sort of SEO, so you're writing content, you're doing optimization bits and pieces, again, you want to be able to measure what those changes actually are. And it's really also to determine who's visiting your site. So understanding your customer, who is actually visiting your site, who's coming back, who are the user bases that you should actually be targeting. So basically, the good thing about Google Analytics is you can collect everything. So if you're really into statistics and analysing bits and pieces, it will confuse you initially, but there is a lot of data and a lot of detail you can actually gain out of it. So quite simply, to get started, you need to sign up for a Google Analytics account. Being Google, of course, it means you need to have a Google account to start with. So all you've got to do is sign in. Go to google.com/analytics and it'll sort of start to step you through the process. It's a very simple sort of thing, sort of shows up there. Basically what they'll provide you is a tracking code. So if you've ever visited especially European sites where cookies and bits and pieces must be announced, and they've got a thing down the bottom to say, you know, you're currently visiting a site and there's a cookie to track you. Most of that is normally Google Analytics. About 70% of sites have Google Analytics running on it. And what you'll sort of get is a funny sort of string that looks like this. This is obviously just an example one, but basically that string is then unique to your site. So Google then give you a little bit of code. Or of course, being WordPress, there's plugins available. So one of the most common ones used is the Google Analytics by Monster Insights. So this plugin not only adds it to your site to track, but it can also display some of the stats as well. Or if you've got a pre-existing sort of paid theme, like Avada or Divi in bits and pieces, they normally have a section where you can add that sort of code in. So Avada just have a nice field to add your tracking code in, so all you've got to do is copy that code in. Divi just give you a spot to copy the code in. And again, Google give you that code that you can just copy and paste in there. So basically, that's all it takes to get set up and start to analyse who's visiting your site and where they're sort of coming from. So then the real fun begins, is actually analysing all of the data that's collected. So I'll go through some of the basics of this. Nearly every section in here you could spend 40 minutes talking about, and some of the SEO guys would love to spend that amount of time talking about. So I'll just try and give the overall sort of picture to guide you through. So one of the key things if you're reading blogs about content and SEO and sort of analysing your data and how long people should spend on your site and how many pages they should visit, is there's no real perfect number. The numbers will be unique to you and your site. So depending on the page, depending on your market, each of that's going to change each time. So if you're reading articles where they say, you know, they must spend 10 minutes on the site, they must spend this amount of time, don't necessarily take them as gospel. But what it will give you is the ability to measure the change. So if they were spending 20 seconds, you've added more content, they're now spending a minute on your site, you've got a good improvement. So you've got that change there to measure. So the other thing to remember about comparing is to compare the same time periods. Like everybody, Monday mornings can be a bit of a drag, so if you're comparing sort of Mondays to Tuesdays, you'll see different data. So if you're going to look at it, look at the same period sort of each time. Weekends especially, you might get different markets looking at it. So it may be that you need to look at those time periods and analyse and sort of optimise differently for those as well. So in old terminology, a lot of people used to measure their website by the amount of hits onto the site. So it was a great way to inflate the number of people to the site, because a hit sort of measures any sort of request to the server. So if you've got 100 images loading, that would generate 100 hits every time somebody loaded the page. Google tends to talk about sessions mainly, and also users. So they're the real value. So users are essentially unique visitors to the site. Little cookie gets stored on their machine. So if they return, they'll actually generate another session, and therefore you can sort of measure that as well. And yeah, so sessions are just how many times that user came back and how many times they sort of loaded the site. One of the really neat things about Google Analytics is it'll actually give you real-time data. So if you've got a lot of people coming to your site, it's a really good motivator to actually see people hitting your site, where they're going to, and you know where they're also coming from. So Google gives you a real-time sort of view of that data as it's sort of flowing through. Audience. So the main sort of section, I guess, to analyse is you've now got sort of the data of how many sort of overall users to your site. So Google will break that down into sort of subcategories as well in terms of how many new users versus how many returning. So you can see this site, we've got only 20% returning visitors and yeah, about 80% sort of new visitors. So if you've sort of started a new marketing campaign and looking for new customers, these are the sort of figures that you want to be looking at. Are you actually getting the same users coming back, or are you getting more users or new users to your site? So one little tip, and a lot of people forget to do it because they think they'll remember, is when you're making changes, Google allows you to add annotations. Basically, allows you to log events. So if you publish a blog or you get featured on a website, you make a change, like you optimize your site or load a new plugin or upgrade WordPress, you can actually mark that in a time period there. So you can see over time and see to go back. Because sometimes you'll get a spike in traffic or a dip in traffic and you'll remember at the time, but 12 months later when you go, what was that funny spike again? You can actually reference that to see actually what's occurred.
Where do you go to do that?
So if it sort of shows up, when you're in the any of the sort of user sort of views, you'll see the create new annotation on the side here. So basically there should be the blue little link there. If you don't have any there, you won't see any of the yellow sort of bars. So if you've got multiple ones, they're normally hidden by default, and that's what the little drop down at the bottom provides for you. So it shows up as the little, I guess, comment sort of field along your timeline. So another good thing, and thankfully it's becoming less and less of a problem, but still very much a problem, especially if you're targeting government users, is what browser are people using to browse your site? Browser compatibility is unfortunately still a problem. So you can sort of look at the data and go, if my customer base, like for example here, is nearly 60% Chrome, and only 3% of users are actually using Internet Explorer. Is it worth my time to make sure it works perfectly for Internet Explorer? Or am I sort of wasting money and time and effort that could be spent elsewhere? So you can get an insight into what your customer base is. These figures are sort of based on, I can't even remember what sort of time frame of our sort of website and snapshot, but they are typical figures. You'll typically see Chrome as the biggest sort of browser usage these days. You can also then dig into it to get their operating system details as well. So if you were selling software or selling systems, you probably want to know whether they're a Mac user or whether they're a Windows user, and therefore, are you attracting the right sort of user base? And of course, mobile. Everything, of course, is now sort of flipped on its head. It used to be that it was designed for desktop and sort of make things responsive so that it would render on your mobile. These days, depending on the market and the sort of industry you're in, some people or some industries are mobile first now, because majority of their traffic is now on mobile devices. So things like Facebook and bits and pieces, there are more people that browse Facebook on their phone than they do on the desktop. Desktop's in a massive sort of decline in that sort of market, and e-commerce and service sort of industries. So you can see that change over time as well. So Google Analytics, you can go, well, what was it like this time last year? And if it has started to swing heavily, you can go, well, you know, this year I need to spend the time to actually start to do all the mobile optimizations rather than just sort of the bare minimum to make it work. You can then break it down into the particular device and phone that they're using. So it will give you as much detail as you sort of want on those sort of users. So for this instance, obviously 30% were iPhone users. So you can sort of go, well, they're the market I'm after, or you know, I made sure it worked perfectly on the mobile phone, so therefore, or on an iPhone, 30% of my market's, you know, going to see the site perfectly. You can see on the list there were two users that used a Windows RT tablet, which is a little bit of a Microsoft thing that came and went very quickly. But you can sort of look at it and go, well, two users, there's no point making it work for them. They're sort of not going to give me any return. So acquisition. Gave two examples sort of here of two different sites. And basically, this is sort of telling you where people are coming from. So organic search is all your search engines. You're looking at, majority is still obviously Google these days. People are, you know, Googling for your content or your site and sort of coming through that way. You got then got people that have come direct. So they've typed your URL into the browser or had a bookmark sort of thing and gone there. You then got referral traffic. So if you've been linked from another site or linked from another blog, this is your referral traffic. And then, of course, your social media side. So you've got your everything from YouTube to Facebook to Twitter, Instagram. So you can sort of track where those users are actually coming from. And depending on your market, these values are going to vary quite significantly. So just to give a sort of bit of a breakdown, this was just another sort of example. If you're a blogger sort of thing that does a lot of YouTube sort of videos, you can see very heavily everything came from YouTube for this particular site. Basically, you can start to break down to work out where your market's coming from. So if you need to optimize for a certain market, or you ran a campaign, you boosted your, you know, YouTube ads, or you ran Facebook ads, you can start to actually measure how many people that brought to your site, because you can see the path that they came to you. So again, from a social media point of view, it covers automatically all the different social media platforms. You may only have two or three different platforms that you're targeting, but at least you'll see how many people were coming from there. So one of the good things about Google Analytics is you can compare different time periods. So you can go, this month I ran a campaign, or last month I ran a campaign. Did I sustain users, or did they start to drop down? And you can also see, maybe you didn't share the content, but somebody else shared your content. So this week I had an extra 1,000 people visit the site. Where did they actually come from? This gives you a summary, but you can keep digging down to the exact URL, essentially, that referred you there. So it gives you that opportunity to sort of really figure out where your market's coming from. Page views. So Meetup actually gives you the ability to track page views as well. So I sort of just pull them out as a quick example, obviously as one of the organisers of the Ipswich sort of Meetup. So you can see which page they came into your site, you can see how many hits, and then you can sort of dig detail quite heavily down into those sort of areas. Especially if you've got multiple landing pages, so you may be targeting a Brisbane market and you've tailored a page for them, you can see whether they've come in via that site. From a kinetics point of view, we have one, our very first sort of support article that we ever wrote has somehow been our most popular one on the entire site. We have no idea why or how, but we always see it. So analytics sort of gave us that view to sort of figure out where are all these users coming from? So we could see multiple different forums sort of linking and bits and pieces. So we wouldn't have known that sort of looking at it unless we, you know, really started to dig down into the data. Analytics, you look at it in seconds and you can already start sort of digging into that information. So site speed. So as Rob sort of touched on, your website performance matters, and matters greatly. It matters from a SEO perspective, it matters from an engaging a user perspective. If your site's not loading quickly, users will become very disinterested very quickly. I think Amazon said they can, I think for every 0.1 of a second slower their site loads or perceived to be loaded, they lose 1% sort of thing of their, you know, potential market. So users can drop off very, very quickly if you've got a slow loading site. So the good thing about analytics is it also starts to break down that data down into multiple different things. So you can see if you're targeting more than one region, you can see based on country, you know, is your site loading slow? But especially these days with the different technologies, you can see from a browser perspective. So you can see for this example, Firefox is obviously, you know, the quickest to load the site, but Internet Explorer is twice as slow to load this particular example. So you could sort of determine if Internet Explorer was a big part of your market and it's twice as slow as everyone else, you need to sort of do some work or, you know, talk to your developer to help sort of optimize that area. But basically you wouldn't gather that information, you know, unless you had analytics there to sort of provide that for you. So behavior flow. So rather than just seeing, you know, they visited your site, they viewed a page, you can now start to dig down into what they're actually doing on your site. So the behavior flow sort of gives you where they sort of started from. So it'll give you the landing page, where they came in, and then it'll start to show you the first interaction and second interaction. So the good thing about this is you can go, well, they dropped off straight away, or they dropped off at this point. So this is where I need to optimize. So if you're running a e-commerce platform and your end goal is to get them to the checkout, but they stopped at the product page or they stopped at the checkout and sort of didn't complete, you can sort of see where they drop off and it'll give you percentages of where those users dropped off. You may be running...
Yep. It's just easy to find tabs so you don't have to go looking for them or anything?
Yep, so I can, yeah, give you a quick...
I haven't seen a couple of them, but that's just my ignorance as opposed to anything, I guess.
That's right, yeah, I should show the flow of how to find them, but basically you can start to see, you know, where users are dropping off and why they're dropping off, and it may be that you're running two different campaigns, so you can see the results of, you know, did this one actually help convert, did it get them through to, you know, filling out a contact form, did it get them to the shopping cart, did they stop the front page, or do they get two pages in and then drop off? So you can sort of work out where you need to spend the time to optimize and add content or figure out what the users, you know, sort of were missing. And of course, being Google and being able to collect lots of data, it'll give you a little bit of demographics. So you can sort of get an idea of, you know, what age group is sort of visiting, whether they're male or female. So this can be especially important from an e-commerce point of view. And this data will obviously change. So you can filter it by all users. You can go down to particular products. So you may run an e-commerce platform that targets, you know, multiple different demographics, whether it's by sex, by age, and you can sort of go, well, are they actually funneling into the right area? Are they viewing the pages I wanted them, you know, targeted at them? Or have I got a problem? So you can sort of dig out some of that detail to find out where your users are coming from and sort of who they are. So average time on page, this is probably the biggest question I normally hear about from an SEO point of view, and again, there is no magic sort of figure. People's engagement, as I sort of, you know, was pointed out, that 8 seconds is a common, you know, engagement that people will hold these days. I've seen people write blogs that are detailed and thoroughly interesting sort of blogs that, you know, maybe 4,000 words and take you, you know, a good 10 minutes to digest. The average time on page can be very low. It may be that users dropped off very quickly. It may be that, you know, it wasn't targeted at the right market. So it may be great content. So those times will vary. So basically, if your average time on page, you've got to look at the page. If it's heavy on content and they're dropping off, you know, within 60 seconds, you may have an issue. If it's a contact page, then obviously they're probably not going to spend, you know, more than a minute sort of filling out their details or adding their email address into a list. So always sort of reference the time that you want them to spend on the page to the actual page and the content that they've got. And bounce rate. So essentially, don't be scared by the numbers. The majority of websites have 80%+ bounce rates for most of their pages. So this basically means they came in and looked at a page and they went. Yeah, so they didn't go any further, didn't look at any other pages. And that can be, you've got to look at why that is. From a kinetics point of view, we have a lot of support articles. If they've got the information they required and, you know, they did a Google search, found the, you know, page that fixed their solution, there's no reason for them to actually go and click, you know, 20 other links sort of thing. So you've got to look at the why of the bounce rates.
If you look at the why, can you go back to that behaviour flow tab? Will that tell me why am I not leaving?
You can certainly, yeah, start to sort of dig out the information. So if there's a choke point, essentially, of where you want to, you know, start users from and get users to, and they're stopping at some point, then obviously, you know, if that page has a high bounce rate, then you probably need to change something there. So if you're an e-commerce platform or a service sort of industry, so, you know, if you're running a plumbing website and you want people to book at the end, but they're stopping at the page that has your price on or has, you know, not enough, there may be something missing that they've sort of become disinterested. So commonly what's used is a call to action. And that's an easy way of sort of gathering users. It may be that they're leaving your site. As much as it's an annoyance, a lot of the sites where you move your cursor away from the browser or go to hit back and it pops up and says, before you leave, you know, enter your email address or bits and pieces. It's a very effective way of doing things. The other is to have, you know, if you're writing blogs and bits and pieces, is to get users to sign up. That way you can send them an email when you've got new content and you can drive them back to your site on a constant sort of basis. So some of the little advanced features that you can sort of dig out of analytics. One of the really neat features I find is being able to set goals. And this is just being able to track conversions. So from an e-commerce point of view, it's an easy way to, you know, you want to get people to the shopping cart. But if you're running a basic website and you want them to contact you, then one of the easiest conversions to try and track is, did they go to the contact page? You know, did they, it doesn't, you can even just measure, you know, did they make it to the page? They don't have to fill out the form. If they went and looked up your details to find your number or bits and pieces, then you know you've got sort of their interest. So if your whole goal is to sort of get them, you know, to engage with you, you can sort of start to track that process. So there's a number of different examples that Google will sort of give you out of the box, whether you want them to place an order, go to the contact us, whether you want them to read reviews and sort of run through. So to set up a goal, this is where you actually have to do things. So most of the other areas in analytics, you're essentially just clicking and it's more of a digestion of information rather than adding information in. Goals, you sort of have to do a little bit of setup. And the admin area can be a little bit confusing, but literally just to track the contact sort of pages, all you have to do is that, you know, you put your URL in. So if they went to /contact on your website, that's a conversion, you know, that's a goal that you've set. What you can also do, and you can see that's sort of listed optionally, is set a funnel. So it may be that you wanted to take them through a journey. So if you're a builder or, you know, have a building sort of website, you may have wanted the users to actually have a look at some of your display homes first, because then you know you've got the right market, you've got them interested. And so you can build up a funnel to sort of flow through there as well. So probably not quite able to read down the back, but what the really interesting bit out of some of the goals and bits and pieces also gives you is it'll look at your previous data. So if you thought, you know, I should have been tracking this goal, it'll actually start to give you some of the information. So you can see for this particular goal, would have had a 3.6% conversion rate based on your last 7 days. So if I wanted users, you know, to view our support articles and then go to our contact page, we would have had a 3% sort of conversion rate out of that, which is quite good. So exportable reporting. Especially if you're a web design agency or have customers, you can sort of set up automation to start sending them reports and sending them information. There's a add-on for Google Sheets, which is the sort of Excel equivalent, where you can actually pull this information directly into Google Sheets. You can then set it up on an automated basis to generate a report to email out and bits and pieces. So you make yourself look really good in front of a customer because you've got all this systems doing all the work, making reports and charts in the background and sending it sort of through to them. One of the new areas where Google has built yet another tool and made it available is a Data Studio. So it's just datastudio.google.com. And this is sort of an example of building one of their sort of tools. So if you've ever sort of wanted to lay out graphs and bits and pieces on a page and figures and numbers, what Google allows you to do is build this as a template. So it doesn't render it in terms of there your fixed numbers. You can have it as a dashboard. You can send a link out to a client, give them sort of read-only access so they can view that data all the time. It may be tailored, obviously this example's from a search point of view. You know, what keywords are people searching for? It may be that you have multiple different sort of the search reports or the Data Studio sort of reports. Allows you to add multiple pages and export bits and pieces as well. So you can have a 20-page report that you've customized. You do it once, you can then import data from every single site you have, run it through, generate and sort of provide that sort of information. So it's a really neat way, especially if you've got a dashboard display or want to sort of really customize how these sort of graphs and how the data that comes out of Google Analytics sort of displays. Data Studio is sort of a fairly new tool from Google, so they're still adding bits all the time into their system. I'd say over sort of the next 12 months, they'll continue to enhance and sort of make the process easier as well. And of course, everything out of Google these days is sort of being driven by all their artificial intelligence, so they've built it into Analytics as well. So there's this little blue icon that appears on the right-hand side now, and you can start to, at the moment, typing, but you can ask it questions. So you can go, how many users visited my site this week? Or, you know, what's the most popular browser in January? So you can start to use English terms, and it will sort of generate data and report for you in a much more usable manner. So if it all becomes overwhelming, give this a go. It's actually quite good. If you haven't used Google Home, where you can just sort of ask questions, this is a very similar sort of interface. So you can see in this example is, how many users did we have last week? And it's told you that, you know, told me that there was 4,177 users. So rather than trying to figure out, because analytics can become confusing with multiple different tabs and areas, you've got a central point, you can just get a nice simple figure out of there from. So alternatives. Obviously this has all been focused on Google Analytics. Some people do have an aversion or a workplace restriction where they can't use Google. Google does obviously collect this information that they can also use anonymized sort of elsewhere as well. So a lot of people, you know, want to know what's sort of available. There's one main sort of example, and of course, when I went to view their website, they've now rebranded again as of about a week ago. So Matamo, I think I've pronounced it right, is their new sort of name, but it was Piwik, which is an open source sort of analytic platform. So it works in a reasonably similar manner to Google Analytics. It's probably not as advanced, but the advantage is because it's open source, you can run it on your platform. They also have a hosted version as well. And of course, being WordPress is a nice, easy plugin that you can just install and sort of integrate with your site. So if you're running it yourself, the downside is obviously that you need to maintain it. So you need to be the one sort of running the updates and bits and pieces. Google is software as a service, so you don't have to do any software updates and bits and pieces. The only other main alternative is a lot of hosting companies have little sort of inbuilt stats and bits and pieces. Basically don't use these stats. They won't give you any real value sort of out of the system. All they'll give you is how many hits to your site. And a lot of browsers and a lot of systems these days are scrubbing information and Firefox just announced recently that they're going to start scrubbing the referral out. So generally when you clicked on a site, it sort of sent that information. You know, if you clicked on a link in Facebook, when you clicked on that link, it sent referral sort of information to your site. So you could see it came from Facebook. From a privacy perspective, the browsers are now starting to remove that information. So the information that you get just on your web hosting point of view is going to get less and less and less and less in the sort of server logs. So any of the inbuilt systems are going to you know, not give you the full story and certainly not going to give you any actual value out of the data. If you know 200 people visited your site, it doesn't sort of give you any value to go, well, you know, where did they come from and who, you know, which sort of social media platform. And that's my quick sort of run through of Google Analytics. So noting that we've got pizzas hot and sort of turned up at the back, I'm happy to take questions.
It's more just like a public service announcement. So you showed a screenshot of like a couple of themes where you can put the analytics code into the theme. It's not really a very good idea because if you change themes in a couple of years, so you put your Google Analytics code in, 2 years down the track you change themes and at some point you realize you're not getting any Google Analytics data anymore. So one of the themes in question that was shown is not supposed to be doing that, but because they're fairly old, but we had certain requirements in place for them, they are allowed to do it for the moment, but probably at some point in the future they won't be allowed to do that anymore.
Okay. Another good example to use a plugin that sort of helps you do it, because then you can ensure that it's, if you change themes, it'll be tracked. Yeah.
Sorry. When you set up Google Analytics, you can set up multiple site references, http://motomo.com, https://motomo.com, http://www.motomo.com. Do you have any comment about which way you should?
So from a Google Analytics perspective, because it's using that unique tracking code, it doesn't really care too much. There is where you can set the preferences in there to help filter out some of the data. Where it makes a big difference is within the Google Search Console, which is...
Correct, because you've got to go back and look at every single one to look at the results. But is there any way of forcing it to use or pick? Would you use what's in your WordPress setup?
Basically, yeah, use what's in your WordPress setup. Analytics is smart enough to, because WordPress will always, if you go to, like if you use www. Or HTTP and it's a HTTPS sort of domain, WordPress will automatically redirect that user anyway to that. So that's where the data, or the real value is going to be. So yeah, make sure it matches what's in WordPress. Unfortunately, Google, from their Search Console, which is sort of not shown in this talk, you can't change it. So you've got to re-add it again and then re-link it back into Analytics. So there's no ability to change within their sort of system there. Yeah?
Does Google have the API option available on that? For example, if you want to read a particular data from that analytics, so do you have that option?
Absolutely, yeah. So Google has, like everything they've got APIs sort of galore. They've got automatic exporters there. Like the Data Studio is one example where it just sort of remotely connects in to sort of pull that information in. They've got their BigQuery and all their other sort of platforms where you can export data quite easily out of the system. Yeah.
What sort of money are you talking about, like to implement the different levels of this?
So, unless you're, I think, 200,000 pages a day above, it's free. So it's completely free. All of the tools that were shown, all of the areas, all of the sort of views that they give you are completely free. And I know even the big guys who are doing much more than what they should be allowed to on the free system continue to sort of go on. So from Google's perspective, they provide it for free because they get, I guess, anonymized, generalized sort of data out of it. So they can get the trends of, you know, what browsers people are using. They can get trends of that sort of information. So that information's valuable enough to them that they can offer their tool sets for free. So just to sort of show, if you haven't ever sort of looked through analytics, all of the tabs and bits and pieces I was talking about, so you've got the real-time sort of views, you've got the audience. And if you want to play around, Google give you access to some of their demo sort of bits. So this is their demo, one of their demo sort of stores. So you can see the users coming in, because you may not have enough data yet to sort of start, if you want to start playing around and seeing how it works. So you can bring up the audience sort of overview. And that's where you can start to see the users dig down into the details. So you may want to dig down from a country point of view. You know, where are these users coming from? So it allows you just to keep digging and digging and sort of pulling in further layers and layers and layers. And again, this is your little intelligence sort of link up the top. So if you want to ask, you know, how many users came last week? You know, what are my best referring sources? So it's trying to give it a nice human way of asking questions and sort of gathering that information out. It then shows you in terms of search. So you can start to look at, you know, this is obviously just looking at February. I want to look at the last 30 days. I want to look at the last 60 days. Or the other thing it allows you to do is compare. So all you've got to do is tick compare to, and it will compare automatically to the previous sort of period. So if I hit apply here, you can see the orange line is the comparison. So it'll sort of show you that, you know, this particular example, you know, there was a 1% sort of drop in users. If you're an Amazon where you've got millions of users a day, a 1% sort of drop is probably significant. If you're a small business, 1% is, you know, probably within, you know, the typical sort of statistical differences that sort of occur naturally. But it sort of gives you that ability, so you can start to see whether there was a big swing, there was a little swing, and, you know, what actually occurred then. So if you've done the right thing, you can see here the little annotation. We could see what went on. So you can see a rise in traffic here. So you can sort of remember, so that's when I published an article, or, you know, this particular example, I just said it, you know, got featured on news.com.au. So normally, if it's on a big site, you'll see a steep sort of incline. But you can sort of start to see and, you know, compare to the previous sort of timeframes.
Yeah. With the post pages and stuff in WordPress, is there any sort of functionality to add like those things from your page, or do you have to go into analytics and do it?
If you've got it like within a plugin sort of thing, it automatically adds it into every single page. So that little tracking.
The things that you make that say, oh, I did a blog post here, like in the analytics.
I don't know if there's an automated system to automate the annotations. Yeah, so that potentially there is a plugin that's available to sort of do that, because yeah, if you can save yourself time, potentially that can be added in as well. Any other questions? I'm sort of floating around rest of the night, so if you've got other questions you just want to ask, and I'll try and answer them for you. Absolutely brilliant. Thank you.